Yeah, hi everyone. I decided to make a short bonus video, stuff in the news, interesting things related to deep learning. So here I'm just briefly talking about cool things I discovered in the news this week related to deep learning. And I think it's just fun to talk about the recent developments in deep learning just to stay up to date with things. So I'm planning to release such a video every week if I have time. So it's also only optional, so you don't have to watch them. So it's something, just watch it if you're interested in. If not, don't worry about it. This is just like some fun additional video content for this class. So then, yeah, let me get started and let me tell you what happened in the world of deep learning this week. Yeah, let's start with a cool application of deep learning for COVID-19 resource needs predictions from a series of X-rays. So this was a project by Facebook AI Research in collaboration with medical doctors at NYU. And it's always cool to involve domain experts. I think that's super important. As I mentioned in the lectures, it's always a good idea to consult people who actually have some expertise in the data that you're working with, especially if it's an important application like a medical application. So in this case, the researchers trained three models to predict patient deterioration and to help predict the resource requirements like oxygen. So here in the first model, they predicted the deterioration of the patient from only one X-ray image. They did the same thing, the same prediction task, now from also a series of X-rays. And the third model was predicting the oxygen supply needed for helping a patient that was also based on a single X-ray. So of course, it's usually helpful to have multiple X-rays that can also then boost the performance if you have a sequence of X-rays and you can tackle this as a time series problem. However, these models also work if only one single X-ray is available. So how they approached this modeling task was that they pre-trained the deep neural network on a large non-COVID chest X-ray database. So they used a general X-ray database. Why did they do that? That's because they had a larger data set available this way, because there are only limited numbers of X-rays from COVID patients at this point. So here they used self-supervised learning. Remember from the lecture, self-supervised learning is this new trend where you pre-train a model on a so-called pretext task, and then you fine-tune it to your target dataset. So here they did the fine-tuning based on a smaller COVID-19 X-ray dataset where they had 27,000 X-rays from 5,000 patients. And what was interesting is that these methods they developed outperformed human experts on some of the measures. So of course it's not a good idea probably to replace humans, but I think developing these systems can be really useful to help humans, because everyone is stretched very thin these days, especially due to the large amount of patients at hospitals right now. So maybe the doctor's task can be done more effectively in the combination with deep learning, especially, for example, if you think of medical staff that is maybe a little bit tired, having a deep learning system taking also a second look at these images, X-rays, could maybe help avoid making mistakes. So you can find the full paper here on archive, and they also uploaded the pre-trained models on GitHub if someone is interested. Regarding COVID-19 research, so on archive, which is a preprint server, there's a large amount, thousands of papers or manuscripts, preprints, uploaded regarding COVID-19. So this is a general preprint server for machine learning. We have a lot of papers on this server, so I help moderating the machine learning categories. And every day there are about 140 new papers about deep learning and machine learning. So it's like a huge amount of papers. I think there are now in total like 14 million papers across different research domains. In any case, you can use the search function to also search for specific research. And here I try to search a keyword combination to also bring up more COVID-19 related research with deep learning. So what I showed you here on the previous slide was pretty cool, but of course it's not the only approach using deep learning for COVID prediction from chest x-rays. So here, using these search terms, you can find many more works in this area. But yeah, also you have to take this a little bit with a grain of salt, because not all of these papers have undergone a peer review. So some of the findings, yeah, may be spurious or maybe less rigorous. So always take archive papers with a grain of salt. I will post the link so you can access these papers if you are interested in that, for example, for the context of your class projects. Yeah, there was another interesting research project related to COVID-19. It was the learning of the language of viral evolution and escape. So this was an article where the researchers described the training of a bidirectional LSTM. So an LSTM, LSTM stands for long short-term memory. It's a recurrent neural network of flavor. It's a particular, you can think of it as a particular version of the RNN, and we will talk also about that more later in this course. So here they trained a bidirectional LSTM. Bidirectional just means that they process a sequence from both ends, from beginning to end and from the end to the beginning. And it's a language model. So here they treat the amino acid sequence corresponding to a virus. They treat this as a language model, like text, for example, and they also draw some analogies from language modeling. For example, they consider the context of being grammatically correct as biologically being correct. Like, is this like a correct sequence, a correct amino acid sequence? Is it a plausible one? And then also considering its semantic meaning. So here, in context of a language, the semantic meaning would be the meaning of the sentence. Here it's whether the sequence causes immune responses or not. And they got a pretty good performance. They have a 0.85 AUC. AUC stands for area under the curve, which is rather ambiguous, because what curve do we mean here? If there's no context, if you see something like AUC in a paper, it usually means receiver operating characteristic area under the curve, so ROC. That's a measure of false positive and true positive rates if you shift the prediction threshold, but that's maybe too much detail at this point. So what's important is that a 0.5 is random, so 0.5 is a random prediction, and 1.0 is a perfect model. So in this way, they are closer to a really good model than to a random or bad predictor. So that is another interesting COVID-19 paper. Moving on to the more like business side of AI or deep learning, there was also something I found really interesting, or not that interesting, but it was like quite a headline. So there's like a project called Human AI that just got 3.2 million of funding to build a personal intelligence platform. So here, that sounds very interesting. So what it is about is that they are building an individual personal AI that is secured by a blockchain to retain and recall information. So you have two buzzwords in here. So you have the AI and blockchain. So this is building a knowledge base in a way, it sounds like it, but based on an individual's information. So you can maybe also think of it as a second brain. So they say it's made possible through a convergence of neuroscience, natural language processing, and blockchain to deliver seamless in-the-moment recall. GPT-3 is built on the memories of the public internet, while Luther, that's their system, is built on the memories of your private self. So it sounds like they're attempting to build a second brain, or a digital copy of your brain. So that kind of also reminded me of this movie scene here, or actually TV show scene. Might be also fun to let me know if you know this, what the name of the TV show is, as a little side quiz here. Moving on, so regarding access to data, to make a transition here, there's also a cool initiative by Twitter. So Twitter is opening up its full tweet archive to academic researchers for free. So there have been projects before, academic projects, where people used Twitter data, but as far as I know, it was a little bit tedious to access the data through the API, because there were some limitations. Now they say they want to make this easier and to give more access. So they say, for example, they are giving applicants, approved applicants, a higher monthly tweet volume cap of 10 million tweets so per month, which is 20 times higher than what it was before. And yeah, they also allow more precise filtering to help researchers pinpoint tweets and other relevant data to what they are studying, basically. So in that way, making research based on Twitter a little bit more convenient. So what can you do? What is Twitter data useful for? Why is that actually cool? So there are actually quite some projects involving social media data that are quite useful beyond just simple sentiment analysis. So here I saw another news article where they're using artificial intelligence to manage extreme weather events. So in this research, they use social media contributions, for example, tweets, to more usefully manage crises. So they developed a noise reduction mechanism to filter for valuable information from social media to better assess trouble spots where there are, for example, floods or snowstorms and so forth. So that was another interesting application of deep learning where information can be efficiently accessed to help certain areas where there are problems. Okay, talking about data sets, large data sets. So one data set that is very common in the deep learning community, very commonly used as a benchmark, is the ImageNet data set. I think it's already 15 years old. It has been released around 2005, 2006. It's still very popular. It's a very large data set, about 14 million images. And it's usually used for evaluating the classification performance of image models like convolutional neural networks or now also visual transformers. So the problem though is that the image data set is kind of notorious for mistakes, and there are also incomplete labels. So sometimes you have multiple objects in an image. For example, as shown here, you have a cow here, and then a barn, and maybe also sky in the background. So there are multiple things going on. Oh, actually, they call it an ox here. It's the fence. I just see it here. It's the fence here. So there are multiple objects in this image. And if you train a classifier, a regular classifier, usually it only gives you the most confident class label as the prediction. So if you have a classifier that predicts barn, it may be wrong because the image was just labeled with ox here, or cow. And in that way, the classifier may be correct, but you are counting it as a misclassification. So here in this project, the researchers are relabeling ImageNet. So they are adding multiple labels to the image here. So they are using also machine learning to do that, because it would take a lot of people or resources to look at these 14 million images and to assign the correct labels. So they make their life easier by also using deep learning for that. So it's kind of like a chicken egg problem. What comes first, the data set or the model? And the model can then be used for labeling the data set. Here, what they do is they use a different data set. They use 1 billion images from Instagram, and they train a model called EfficientNet for training this model to become a machine annotator to annotate the 14 million images in ImageNet. They use crop regions for that. So they are cropping different regions of the image. So for example, as shown here, they are cropping the image into smaller regions and then apply a classifier to each of these smaller regions to obtain the class label, and then have this multi-label context for each image. That is also something I found actually useful and interesting. Another project from Facebook AI research. Here I also thought that might be a cool application of machine learning and deep learning that has some use for the real world. So what Facebook did is they used AI to improve photo descriptions for people who are blind or visually impaired. So they developed a smartphone app that where you can take a picture, and that app can then describe what can be seen in that picture, like an audio message. So this system has been around, I think, for a couple of years, but they are just improved it to make it more accurate. So here they trained a ResNext model on 3.5 billion Instagram photos and the corresponding hashtags. And they also combine it with a fast RCNN object detector to describe different aspects of this image. So for example, here in this example, the description is, it may be an image of one person standing on or at Machu Picchu. So going back here, this is kind of similar to these crop regions where people have these different crops of the same image and then assign a label. Here it's a similar approach that you have, for example, person, Machu Picchu, and so forth. But the addition here is that there's also a text describing this or putting this into context.